What's up, everybody? Welcome into Guerilla Hockey with JJ and Jesse. We're back for another episode to wrap up the homestand that was, Jesse. It was a fun little homestand.
JJ Prime. I can't believe it, you aren't going to acknowledge those the
I
very
knew you were
first
going to.
Thing.
I right, knew yeah, you'd yeah. bring it. Yeah, I'm rocking my Coach Prime glasses. It took me so long to get these glasses. I ordered these at the beginning of the football season. They must have had so many people order these things that they barely got here, what, a week ago? The football season's already over, so I'm like, I got to wear these somewhere fun and cool. So
who's the brand?
It's called Blenders.
Oh, okay, yeah,
free
yeah.
Free ad for Blenders here.
Well, dude, I mean, good on them for, because I think he was rocking their shades before the CU thing, right?
Yeah. I don't know how it all shook out, but I saw him. I was like, cool. I'm a former CU student here, so I got to support my team, and I wanted to wear these at some of the football games I went to, and I didn't get to. So, like I said, I got to wear them here.
I like, because normally when you see the one-piece lens,
you look like the Terminator.
Well, and they're kind of lame-looking, but I like those because that's like a very traditional shape with like a little bit of stank on it. I like that.
Yeah, I'm feeling prime. I'm feeling prime. I was actually on my way home from the Avalanche game last night, and I heard a little story on the radio about how CU is now introducing a class called Prime Time or something along those lines, where they teach you how to market yourself, especially if you're especially if you're an athlete. So I think it's closed off to like the athletes and the journalism majors.
Yeah.
But still, an interesting idea, and just how much he's impacting that place, right?
Well, so I'll be honest. When you said Prime Time, I thought you meant like, yeah, they're going to teach all about the history of Deion Sanders. I was like, okay, we've maybe gone a branch too far here.
Yeah, Deion Sanders dance class too, right? You got to learn the touchdown celebration. But no, I also got my Christmas sweater on.
I know. I'm blowing it, dude.
It's Christmas
time.
Well,
I listened to Christmas music on the way down here.
Oh.
In the car the whole way. And I was going to say we should make this a Christmas episode, but I'm committing right here on the pod that we are going to do one before Christmas. So that'll be our Christmas episode.
We'll make that our Christmas episode.
Yeah. I'll make you unwrap a gift live on the show. I'm not sure when it'll be yet.
Christmas music is so funny to me because it's like...
Interesting.
It seems like there's a group of songs from, what, the 40s? And then maybe once every... splash 10 years or so, a new song comes out, right? Maybe a Mariah Carey or an NSYNC. But all the bangers, all the classics are kind of grouped from the 40s. Nobody's come up with a new Christmas song in so long. Maybe we should do that too.
No, I don't think you can touch the classics. I think that's why they're Christmas classics.
You make a new classic. You got to keep in mind, at one point, those songs weren't even written.
Somebody
sat down and wrote them. It's not like they're scripture. They haven't been here since the beginning of time. They're from the 40s.
All right, well, you almost got me on that one. I was going to go down a whole new road, but I have something that I want to get off my chest, and I don't even know. We've already been talking about other stuff for so long. I don't know if we should get into that yet. Let's maybe save that for like halfway through the show. That'll be a nice little intermission.
Okay, halftime Jesse rant.
Yeah.
Stay tuned for it. So, yeah, let's get into the homestand, Jesse. I think that's really what's front of mind was the last five games, all of which at Ball Arena, and...
We interrupt this program for an important news announcement.
All right, interrupting your regularly scheduled podcast, JJ and I recorded the evening before Tomas Tatar was flipped to the Seattle Kraken for a fifth-round pick. Now, I was going to do this insert in Winnipeg, on the way to Winnipeg, to be able to drop into the pod to get this out ASAP, but I had some reason to believe that maybe we weren't done yet with the news, so I wanted to wait just so that we wanted to make sure we were putting out the most up-to-date information and news that we have for the Avs. So I waited a couple days. I'm thinking now this is safe to put out. I'm here in Chicago. I'm up in the press box. But I wanted to get this put in here so we get the podcast pushed out. The Avs do flip Tomas Tatar to the Seattle Kraken for a fifth-round pick. And as of right now, 12:47 p.m. Central Standard Time, December 19th. The Avs have not made any additional moves. This move, to me, you only make at this point in the season if they're eyeing something, if they are trying to bring somebody else in, if they have a move that I'm not saying it's necessarily even going to get done. But they have to be looking at something else to make this move. I floated the idea to JJ. We were walking through the halls of Ball Arena just a couple weeks ago, and I said, man, I don't know. if you know, because we're talking about guys that are out there that are available that could be potentially fill in some gaps that, that this group has. And I said, yeah, but if you're going to do that, you know, you need some more money. And gosh, you're probably looking at, you know, trading a guy like, I don't know, Tomas Tatar. But I just don't think they would do that this early in the year with the upside that he had, you know, 7-time 20-goal scorer. I didn't think that they would be punting on any of the guys that they brought in this summer. So that's, you know, Drouin, Tatar, Ryan Johansson. I didn't think they'd be punting on any of those guys this early. But they free up $1.3 million in cap space immediately with the move. And while they haven't made a move yet, you know, as kind of a follow-up, Jared Bednar alluded to the fact we'll have to wait and see what we do next. There's no way something else isn't coming. Right, I think the secondary scoring hasn't quite been there the way that this group maybe thought it would. So I'd have to imagine that that's what they're going to be looking to address. But definitely a move we didn't see coming. Tomas Tatar has already notched a goal with the Seattle Kraken. But the Avs get a fifth-round pick back. But most importantly, what they really get back is some additional cap space and some flexibility against the cap to maybe make some more moves. So we're keeping an eye on this one. But we'll get you back to your regularly scheduled podcast now. Wanted to make sure we threw that one in there, had that information in there. Avs trade Tomas Tatar to the Seattle Kraken for a fifth-round pick. No follow-up moves as of yet.
By the skin of their teeth, I think we can label it a successful homestand.
Yeah, it was a little dicey there for a sec, eh? It's funny because, you know, what's the saying? Winning fixes everything, winning mm-hmm. cures all, whatever the actual... cliche itself is, because you go back to even the night before the Calgary game, and morale was low. Like, you know, we all remarked at morning skate for the Calgary game, no laughing and joking on the ice. It was very serious, mm-hmm. very businesslike. You know, man, I've really gotten away from doom scrolling hockey Twitter this season, and it's been really nice. The little bit that I do see, you know, as it comes into my mentions and stuff like that, not support, but everyone was just very down on where the Avs were, despite them still being the top of the division, you know, despite them being a quarter of the way through the season and still a lot of hockey. You know, people were really, really down on this team. And it's so funny, doing the same thing last night, everyone's back to planning the parade route. So, you know, like, it's... It's the ebbs and flows, of the regular season. And as Jared Bednar said last night, you'd like to win all five on your homestand. But at the end of the day, like you and I have talked about this, as you break this season up, whether it's into 10-game chunks, 5-game chunks, whatever, you came out over 500 on this 5-game homestand. And at the end of the day, as long as you continue to stack points, Jared Bednar used to talk about a philosophy he had. Breaks things up into 10-game chunks. And if we can get 12 points in every 10-game chunk, we're going to be in good position to, you know, put ourselves in a spot to succeed at the end of the year. And so, you know, if you have that and say, okay, well, here's a 5-game chunk, they're on pace to do that. So, like you said, they had to win the last two games to make it a successful homestand, but they did that. So,
yeah, I think it was – you know, in the defense of all the doomsday people, it was an interesting homestand.
Which, JJ is one of them.
I mean, ask my old radio partner, Ryan Boulding. He always calls me a wave rider. I'm absolutely that guy. When the highs are high, I'm up there too. When the lows are low, I'm down there. So, I guess, yeah, the way I was kind of processing the way things were going is, yes, you had that pretty ugly road trip. And then you're like, okay, here's a homestand to kind of write things a little bit. Mm-hmm. Then you started seeing bodies just fall out of the lineup left and right, right? Remember that Anaheim game, the first game of the homestand? Mm-hmm. We looked at the line combinations and we were like, whoa.
Yeah.
I think that was when Ryan Johansson was on the fourth line with Curtis McDermott. Mm-hmm. You had, who was it? Kivi Ranta was somewhere up in the top six, yeah, I think he was. Like, it was just a big jumble of of players. So those two things combined started having me question, okay, A, does the health of this team, is it sustainable all the way through the season? Because it's questionable. Sure, I know it's early December. The other thing is, is Jared Bednar at a point where he's almost throwing his hands up and saying, I don't know what to do with these line combinations. We have to start trying things. We have to try something else. What kind of eased my mind a little bit was Jared Bednar himself kind of saying, like, look, this is an opportunity in the regular season. It's what the regular season's for, to kind of experiment, see what we're working with. It's still early in the season. I'm like, you know what? He's right. This is the time of the year to be doing that. Figure things out. Nail things down. So that way, by the time playoffs come around, you're rolling full steam. You have everything figured out. So go ahead. You're just itching to...
No. Well, I you said something that spurred a thought. So I was actually doing one of those, what you and I were just talking about last night, where I'm like trying really hard to remember it so that I don't forget, because you just said, and I'm talking myself out of forgetting, but keep going.
No, I'm done. Oh, go ahead.
Well, no, because what you just said about, you know, that's what the regular season's for and making sure that you're playing well at the right time of year. That's what I think fans of contending teams struggle to understand, especially a team like the Abs. And I don't even want to say struggle to understand. Struggle to recognize. Because, you know, fandom is an emotional thing. Sports are an emotional thing. But, like, where the Abs are right now, they're going to make the playoffs. They're going to make the playoffs. Something would have to go catastrophically wrong for them to not make the playoffs.
And that was never in question.
Right, right. You know, dude, honestly, even the Edmonton Oilers, as much as I think they're not a good hockey team, like, when you have Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl, they're probably going to make it.
Well, and they're ripping through their schedule right now.
Well, it's because Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl are playing well. And so the Avs are going to make the playoffs. What the regular season is about for them is fine-tuning the details so that come playoff time, you're firing on all cylinders. It's maybe what the 2022 Avs did and what the 2023 Nuggets did have maybe skewed the perspective of Denver sports fans, because those were dominant regular seasons by both teams, and then they cruised through the playoffs. That doesn't normally happen. You know what I mean? Like league champions are not normally world beaters from start to finish. That's rare. But let's take a look at both of those instances, right? I know one of them is basketball, so it's different. But what is the same about both those things is the teams played their best in the playoffs. As good as they were in the regular season, both the Avs and the Nuggets these last 2 years here in Denver, as good as they were in the regular season, they were outright dominant come playoff time. When you're a true contending team, that's what the regular season's for. Let's get ourselves right so that come April, May, June, there's no questions about who we are. We know what our identity is. And we've been through it all. We've gone through the scoring slumps. We know how to dig out of it. We've gone through streaks where we've given up a lot of goals. We know how to dig out of it. Our power play's gone dry. We know how to bounce back. Like, that's what the regular season is meant to be for. It's not, you know, this isn't the NBA. We're not crowning regular season champions here. Like, you know, you get right for the playoffs so that you can compete for a real championship.
Yeah, there's still a banner for President's Trophies, but I get what you're getting at. And, of course, we've talked about this a couple times already, and I think this is a thing everybody needs to remember. And another thing that kind of talked me off the ledge is just the state of the NHL right now, right?
Yes, I was dying to get into this.
We've discussed just over and over about how this is anybody's year. So if you can just get hot at the right time, get your stuff dialed in by the time playoffs come, it's another year where you just got to get in.
I think that is going to hold more true than ever this year. Was it Evan, I believe, you and I were talking with yesterday? To me, man, this season is the flat cap catching up with the NHL. It's been, 3 years, going on 4 years of no cap movement, and this is what we've ended up with. And I'm not saying that in a bad way. This is by far the most parity we've ever seen in the NHL. Dude, even the Sharks are on a bit of a run right now. And, there are so few teams who are separated, you know, notably worse than the rest of the field. I mean, I don't even know if I would say there's a team at the top I would say there's a couple teams: Colorado, Vegas, Boston,
New York.
Let's just say those four, right? Two from each conference that you can, I guess say are in this tier. And then, dude, there's a field of like 25. And then again, the same thing, two or three that are kind of at the bottom. But the overwhelming majority, 90% of the NHL is currently living all within a few points of each other. And it's this like weirdly perfect distribution of talent right now.
Yeah, and I think there is something to that upper echelon, right? You're right. It's a group of teams, and then there's the small pinch of teams that you legitimately think that can do it. You see opponents come in and play those teams, and they're scared. They're game planning a little extra hard. They know how much talent. And I was actually in the Buffalo locker room last night listening to Alex Tuck as I waited for Eric Johnson, and he got into that almost to the point where I was in my head like, well, you are giving them a little bit too much respect here, right?
Yeah.
He was absolutely just like, oh, they have so much firepower. They can score whenever they want, la-da-da-da. And it's like, you just hearing Alex Tuck right there made me realize that even the players are like, no, this Avalanche team is too dangerous to really be able to manage.
So, dude, I'm actually so glad you brought that up. I took a screenshot a couple nights ago. After the Winnipeg game, because you know Winnipeg wins, and now I can't find it. Oh, I bookmarked it on Twitter, but it was so funny, JJ, because one of the quotes from a player after the game was, "Who was it that said it?" I didn't say. Connor Hellebuyck. We proved tonight that we can play with anybody. That's like the third or fourth time I've heard an opposing player playing against the Avs make a comment something like that. You know, yeah, we didn't come up with a win, but we learned tonight we can skate with these guys. Yeah, we found out we can play at this level. We can beat anybody. We can play. The Avs are the measuring stick. Mm-hmm. That's again what's, you know, last year was again funny because, you know, you're in a little bit of an echo chamber when you're in, you know, the city that the team is based out of, because you hear a lot of what the fans think and people around town think. But, like, dude, you and I used to talk about it last year. We'd go to those morning skates and just talk to visiting media, national media, and everyone was like, this, you know, well, I don't know about tonight. Like, everyone outside of Colorado sees the Avs as still this just juggernaut. And, you know, they are, like you said, they're in that upper echelon of four teams that I say, yeah, those teams are going to make it. And I think you're right. Other teams see the Avs as, yep, we're really good. We're pushing, but we're not there. We're not what they are yet.
There's another observation I want to touch on from the Buffalo Sabres locker room last year. Because I don't often go last night. I don't often go into opponents' locker rooms, whether it's morning skate or after the game. And you said it earlier, the other day at morning skate, it was all business. Mm-hmm. No laughing, no smiling. I think I saw Cale Makar slap the boards a little bit for somebody who scored, and that was it.
Mm-hmm.
I go into that Buffalo Sabres locker room, and I'm not going to get too much into detail, but I just felt like I was witnessing a team that's comfortable with losing. Mm-hmm. They were very accepting of the result. There was very much of an energy like, oh, we lost again. And that is not something I've ever seen out of the Avalanche. Even in the 48-point season, there was none of that. They were angry. They were ready to fix it. They wanted to do everything they could to be a good team. Buffalo seems really comfortable not being a good team. And so I just think that culture right there says everything you need to know about where the Avalanche sit among the rest of the NHL.
So, the beginning of this football season, we had our boy D-Mac and Nate Jackson in here after a Bronco game. And I believe it was the game against the Bears. It was the Broncos' first win of the season. And, you know, we were having the conversation of like, well, does this win even really matter? And I made the comment. I said, JJ, until the Broncos learn how to win and stop being okay with losing, no, individual game wins aren't going to matter at all. And you go back to the – so let's go back a little bit before the 48-point season. the famous J.S. Jaguar, Francois Beauchemin blow up. Because guys near the end of the season
were planning their trip to Mexico.
Were you know, they had just gotten their heads kicked in for the seventh game in a row, and in the locker room, the guys were sitting there talking about their trip to Mexico. And that was maybe one of the moments, and you know, I've never talked to, you know, guys like Gabe Landeskog, Nathan MacKinnon about this, but you know, that feels like, when you go back through Avalanche history, one of like the turning points where it's like, are you guys really okay with this being okay? Are you guys are okay just collecting your checks and getting to the end of the season? And then, you know, it was the next year was the 48-point season, and that is where now the now famous Gabe Landeskog story of him knowing he was on the trading block and going into to Joe Sakic's office and saying, look, you got to do what you got to do, but I want to be part of the solution. I don't want to be shipped out to go chase it somewhere else. I want to fix it here. And they made the decision that we are no longer okay with mediocrity. We're no longer okay with just barely missing the playoffs. We're no longer okay with getting our heads kicked in. And everything changed. Yes, it helps to have elite players. And yes, it helps that almost every player Joe Sakic has brought in has fit really well. But you will never convince me that that doesn't all start with the mentality and the culture and setting a winning mindset.
Yeah, no, you're spot on, because I remember that team well. I was young. I was living downtown, and I would often see those guys out at the bars. I would often hang out with them, and I'm talking often.
Yeah.
Like a regular basis, maybe every single weekend, I would be hanging out with two players in particular that were part of that team. I have a good feeling they were probably a big part of talking about the Mexico trip.
Yeah.
But they got those guys out of town, and they started adding.
Not because they were bad dudes, but they were just...
They just weren't fitting of the culture. And that's why you see them finding college captains, former junior captains. And that's why this whole team is filled with leadership now. That's why this whole team is filled with guys who want to be better. That's why Jared Bednar is one of the longest tenured coaches in the NHL. Because they're cultivating the right players to continue his success that can, you know, keep the bus moving. So,
well, and I want to add to that, too. You don't have to be an elite team to start building that culture. You know, people think like, oh, well, yeah, it's easy to have a winning culture when you're winning. That culture started being built in the 48-point season. It was about halfway through that year where the results didn't necessarily change, but the effort, the mindset, you know, you could just tell that things were starting to turn. It started to feel like, oh, damn, they're just not getting the results. You know, as were before, even in the Patrick Waugh years, I tell the story all the time, dude. You know, my dad and I used to talk about it. The Avs were in that stretch. They'd be up in a game 2-0. The other team would score a goal. And they'd pan to the Avs bench, and you'd see everyone like this. They're still winning. But it would just be like this, well, here we go again. In the 48-point year, it felt like they started building the belief that we can come back. We can win. Damn, we fell just short. You know, in this game again. Ah, we came up short. Oh, we get, because that team just, you know, didn't have the players. But the mindset started to shift, and they haven't missed the playoffs since, because it started to build, and you started getting a little bit. Once you address the culture and the mindset, then you can start addressing the personnel. To take this back to your original point, Buffalo, it's part of the reason why it hasn't worked there for so long, despite them having some pretty good borderline elite players at multiple times over the last decade plus. They don't have a winning mindset. And when you don't have a winning culture, you don't have a forward thinking culture, I guess, you can't even start to get into personnel issues.
Well, and also look at who's setting the standards in that room, right? And I look back to that team I was just talking about that used to like to party. And you got these guys showing the young guys how to take shots and how to, you know, this is the hot spots around town. Now what you have is the
Here's
group.
How to be a pro athlete.
Yeah, now you have winners who not only want to win but have won. Mm-hmm. So they can show you exactly the route to take. I highly doubt the Avalanche are going out nearly as much as they were that year I was referencing, if they even are at all. And if they are, they're doing a really good job of hiding it, which they never used to do. So, yeah, you could just from that right there, I know it's off ice, partying, drinking, whatever. It's not hockey, but there's something to read into the shift that we've seen in the last 10 years.
I'll relate it to hockey. How about, because I'm with you. I think that's just as much of a thing. But if people are saying, yeah, it's all ice. Training camp. Nathan MacKinnon goes back to Halifax to have his major junior jersey retired for the Mooseheads. That's a weekend that's all about him. You know, it's something that he totally earned, totally deserved. And he flies home. And he gets home, I think he took a PJ, so I'm assuming he probably just flew straight into Centennial. You know, there's about 90 minutes left in the day for camp. Nathan MacKinnon gets dressed and throws on a green jersey and goes out with the AHL guys. Because doesn't matter that he just took a, you know, had a crazy 30 hours where he flew across, you know, to a different country on the other side of the continent, you know, over and back, and had this whole night about him where I'm sure he had a few drinks and stuff like that. He got on the ice because it's like, nope, I'm here. I can go to work.
And that's exactly it. He approaches it as work, where I feel like there's other players around the league that approach it as a fun job, where he approaches it as work, right? Yep. My locker is my cubicle. I need to go out onto that ice and make sure that I'm trying to get better every single day. So yeah, it's such a good mentality. I know there are times that it's hard. We have to go in that locker room after a loss and stick a camera and a microphone in front of people who don't necessarily want us to be there, and it stinks. But it also is so refreshing to be able to cover a team like this, to be able to cover a team that has high standards, high goals. Not only that, they have just some of the coolest players you could ever cover in the NHL. Mikko Rantanen, Cale Makar, Nathan MacKinnon. I mean, these are NHL all-stars. So we also kind of take that for granted a little bit, right? I mean, you look in Buffalo, they've got some cool names. Okposo, you know, both of their goalies are fun.
Tage Thompson.
Alex Tuch, Tage Thompson. But they're not the same caliber as these Avalanche guys. Mm-hmm. And I think that's another thing that we can kind of chill out on the rough stretch of play there. We saw Cale Makar have the biggest point drought of his career, which stretched over three games.
Yeah.
You saw the Mikko Rantanen drought. What was that? 9 games, I think, that lasted. And Val Nichushkin was feeling under the weather, kind of learning his new life as a new dad, which I can tell you is a challenge in itself. So those things kind of work themselves out too, and they just happen to all kind of sandwich into the same little window of time. So I'm feeling good that that's behind them. As long as this team can stay healthy, I think. But that's so questionable too,
but
right?
I mean,
that's every team. A little bit. Yeah.
That's every team.
Sure. They, you know? This team is just so reliant on the Mikko Rantanens, Cale Makars, Nathan MacKinnons, Val Nichushkins, that when that little bit is broken.
I think that's the part that, to me, that's what I want to see between now and April.
Less reliance on those
guys. And genuinely, JJ, and people may disagree with me on this. What I mean, people will definitely disagree with me on this. I think they've got the guys to do it. And I think this potential emergence of Sam Molinsky is going to allow you to maybe put some more emphasis on adding a top six winger. You know,
Yeah, you're shoring up the defense a little bit. Not to mention right behind him is Caleb Jones, who's been impressive.
Well, exactly. You know, you've got Caleb Jones, who's played well. You've got Sam Molinsky. Plays well, first NHL goal last night. You know, between those two and Jack Johnson, like, I feel totally fine about the Avs 6-7 on D. I made the comment to you, I think it was to you, yesterday or 2 days ago. I think, and I said it this summer, I thought the Avs put too much emphasis on it needs to be a center, it needs to be a center, it needs to be a center. I think the Avs should have pursued who was their best top six option. I think Mikko Rantanen gives you fine reps at center if you need him to. And I think between Ryan Johansson, Ross Colton, Freddie Olofsson, Logan O'Connor, who can moonlight at center, like, you've got enough options at center. Jared Bednar made the comment the other night, we only have 4 centers. Kinda.
They don't. They have like 8.
Right. And Mikko Rantanen played a lot of center before he got to the NHL. He was fine there last year. You can split up him and Nate when needed. Like, I think the Avs should shift their attention to, as we very slowly, still multiple months, approach the deadline. That's where the focus should be. Can we get a top six guy in here?
It's also been a delight to see the guys, and we knew this coming into it. We talked about it before the season even started, how shored up the depth is from the Eagles, too, right? We've seen Riley Tufte come in here and make an impact. Kivi Ranta has been really, I think, a delight to see. He hasn't been amazing, but he's been adequate.
Good.
I think Ben Myers is somebody who's maybe showing a little bit more promise than maybe this time last year. I really like what he's doing on the wing. I feel like, you know, none of us really like seeing Cogliano and Logan O'Connor split up, but we love seeing Logan O'Connor, Ross Colton, and Miles Wood.
Yeah.
I think Ben Myers is a Logan O'Connor light that can play right next to Cogliano and have a similar impact, not the exact same, because Logan O'Connor's really proven to be a strong player, but you like what you've seen from those guys that have had to plug in.
Well, and really, and that's kind of my thing. You're right. Like, you know, the depth isn't quite carrying as much of the mail as maybe you would like them to, but as long as you can get there by the end of the season with a couple of those guys, I like the organizational depth. Like, I think their Black Aces roster come playoff time would be, you'd be very comfortable plugging almost any of those guys into the lineup. So to me, that's where my focus has started to shift now, you know, a week and a half, whatever it is before Christmas. I'm saying, all right, they need a top six player. I don't, and keep in mind, you got Arturi Lehkonen coming back. And you've got Nikolai Kovalenko coming at some point.
And I think Kovalenko is really that little ace up their sleeve right now.
And you know, dude, I was very skeptical at the start of the season. I believe it was our buddy AJ Hayfley. Because someone had put out a list of, like, here are the top performers in the KHL so far. And Kovalenko, I think, was at number two. But AJ pointed out, he said, this is great. This is awesome. Look at all the former Avs that are also on this list. And, you know, it's a bunch of ex-Av players. A lot of the guys from those teams that we were just talking about that are now in the KHL and just lighting it up. Jeremy Smith is, you know, a goaltender of the year candidate every year.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to take a look. You know, I was a little skeptical at first. I mean, dude, he's looking like a real difference maker. Good offensive instincts, physical, has a scoring touch. You know, like I said, isn't afraid to mix it up. Like, to me, he's looking kind of like a Ross Colton type. You know, and if the Avs could add that as a freebie, you take that 10 times out of 10.
Yeah, there's always something special about the players who are the son of a former NHLer, right? Mm-hmm. You and I actually had that conversation about Logan O'Connor recently, and I was like, oh, that makes so much sense.
Never made it to the NHL. I looked it up.
But he was
a pro
in some sense, and I didn't know that about him, and now I understand how he kind of has those intangibles. That's such a football word. Intangibles that I think he brings to the table.
Really, dude? I mean, it is, though. Mm-hmm. Like, that is stuff that it's just – there's no way to be taught how to, you know, how to truly understand and be taught how to behave and how to perform and how to fuel your body and how to take care of your body and how to train if you don't have someone who's been through it and can guide you on that.
Yeah, you're not going to do it as well if you're just trying to figure it out on the fly.
Right.
Along with the former Avs that we were seeing the other day, I was watching NHL Network and they had the European Champions League. Have you seen any of this? They've been starting to broadcast it on NHL Network the last couple of years, and it's fun to watch because it's hockey in the middle of the day on European time schedules. But then you see guys like Martin Kaut out there just dominating, and it just blows my mind. Being like, okay, a year ago I was talking to Martin Kaut right here in Denver. And now I'm watching him play hockey across the world, which is Dylan Sakura was also in that game. So, I don't know, just a fun thing I wanted to throw in there.
I
feel like now...
I can't tell this story.
Now would be a good time for your rant, though.
Yeah, okay, perfect. Remind me to tell you something about Martin Kaut.
Okay.
JJ. I was on the road. I believe I was in Arizona, I think.
So it was the Arizona, Anaheim, LA trip.
Nope, it was LA.
But it was that
trip. It was that trip. I'm sorry. Nope, it was LA. Here's my gripe this week, JJ. When I order food through one of the food delivery apps, I know every job has its... There's things that are difficult about it. Every job is tough. Every job has its stresses. I never like when people put other people down because they work retail or because they work, in the service industry, food, something like that, you know, saying they're easy jobs. They're not. They're tough jobs. I know they are. What I don't think should be difficult is putting the sauce in the bag.
Okay, Cardi B. I'm going to call you Cardi B.
I wrote in my order. Not only did I order the sauce in three separate locations, I put a message. I asked for ketchup in addition to the sauce that I had clicked on the menu. I said, ketchup, please. And I always like to put a smiley face so that they know, hey, I'm
just trying to be courteous.
I'm friendly. I'm a nice guy. I was waiting for that to happen. I'll finish this rant, then I'm going to go address that light. And it gets there. No sauce. No sauce anywhere to be found in the bag. And, like, what bothers me about it is that's a breakdown at multiple levels. The restaurant didn't do it, and the person who went and paid for the food didn't ask. I don't ask for many things in life. I asked for sauce in the bag. I didn't think that was that difficult. And I feel like it happens way more than it should.
It happens more times than not, I would say.
And I would agree with that.
That's hands down the most frustrating part about ordering it, that style, right, with the phone apps. Because not only are you paying three times the amount for that meal, but it's not even coming correctly. And you only have yourself to blame, right? You're like, oh, yeah, it's because of my lazy ass that I didn't get up off my couch and go do this myself. But it's infuriating. I understand.
I won't say I only have myself to blame. I'll say I'll take part in the blame. The instructions are pretty clear.
Well, 20 years ago, to get food, you would have had to leave your hotel and go find it.
Not even 20 years ago.
Not even
5 years ago.
Yeah. So I blame you pre-COVID. Entirely.
Oh,
I'll give you full blame. Well, but no, I bumped into a Cardi B rant where she was going off on the exact same thing. She's
dude.
Like, I ordered Chick-fil-A 2 days in a row. And I'm like, first of all, why are you eating Chick-fil-A 2 days in a row? Like,
it's not
breaks.
Right. It's not enough days in a row. You're right.
And yeah, she was going on the same thing about the sauces that she didn't get. So you are our honorary Cardi B.
Me and
for
my
the
growing
day.
Cardi. Let's take a small little pause here. I think we're wrapping up. We got to be done here in just a few minutes.
Got
anyways,
a couple conversations still to get to.
But I'm going to fix this, so please hold.
Back off a little intermission.
Fixed it.
That's the thing about Guerilla Sports is we operate with so much... technology nowadays. We got three cameras on us, we've got lights, we've got this, we've got that, that sometimes things falter, sometimes you forget batteries, sometimes a light goes out. Let's get back into the conversation, Jess. I think there's a couple things from this homestand that I really want to touch on. Let's start with the goalies, right? I think Alexander Georgiev, I don't think, is starting to get tired, but maybe Jared Bednar is starting to believe that he's getting a little bit tired, right? We saw Ivan Prosvetov a couple times during this homestand, and we even saw Alexander Georgiev get yanked in place of Prosvetov, which ended up being a good move because they won that game. But I guess where are you right now as far as Alexander Georgiev's start quantity? And obviously, I think we can agree that Ivan Prosvetov has been a bit of a delight.
I don't think Alexander Georgiev is physically tired. I think he's chugging through it mentally right now.
Do you think he would admit that though? Like, would he admit that? If you gave him some truth serum
him? I think so.
Do you? I don't know if he believes that. I don't know if he...
He's a very calm, cool, collected kind of guy. Very even keel.
likes to read on his off days. I think that tells you everything.
Very soft spoken, all that stuff. These last hand 5 to 10 games that he's played, not all of them, but at points, he's visibly showing his frustration after goals. You know, the team falls behind, plays that he makes. You know, he talked to me at the beginning of the year about, you know, just how his mindset has evolved. He kind of, you know, proved to himself last year he can be a number one. Now it's about, you know, refining that. And, you know, at the beginning of the year, he said, I feel like I'm seeing the whole play as opposed to just tracking the puck and blah, 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 blah. To me, it seems like he went through that stretch of bad games and he's in his own head a bit. Blake, I'm doing the podcast. He's calling me. Yeah.
Maybe we should take him as a caller. First time, long time.
And to me, it just seems like his game's in his head a little bit because he went through a rough stretch there. He gave up more than 4 goals, however many, was that 6 games in a row or something like that? And I just think he's struggled to bounce back from that. And how many times have we talked about so much goaltending is mental? I think he's going through it mentally right now.
Yeah, I feel like he bounced back from that, but not fully.
Yeah.
He was able to jump in there, make some saves, get some wins. And then, man, Calgary was a game where you're like, what's going on here? And then when he loses his cool a little bit, tries to throw a blocker at Nazem Kadri, you're like, that's not the Georgiev that we're used to, and especially because Kadri wasn't even the one that made him mad there. He just kind of snapped a little bit. So, yeah, I can see that. But again, I don't think he would ever admit to that. I don't think he would. I don't even think he believes that. I think he is ready to just get some momentum, get some strings of starts together, and get some wins. But it's hard to keep giving him that leash when you're kind of getting burned by
it. You don't think that he knows that he doesn't feel right up here like he did at the beginning of the year?
No, I don't think he would chalk it up to anything mental, especially this early in the year. What, he's at 18 starts, something like that? Still under 20. Yeah, he's at the top of the NHL.
See,
in that sense.
I'm not saying like mentally fatigued. I'm just saying I think he's
questioning
his. Yeah, he's having a hard time believing in himself
right now.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I could see that. I could see that, but I don't know. I mean, yeah. Yeah, I guess so. I don't know where to go from there.
I can see it. I don't know. Yeah, no. Yeah, no. Yeah. I'd love to see that like transcribed out what you just said.
Let's put it in captions and post it on Instagram. No, there's obviously stuff he needs to work through, but I don't think it's anything so egregious that you're like, oh,
like do you think he's suddenly any worse of a goaltender? Like, you know what I mean? Like, no.
Like, I'm ready to have him start in Winnipeg.
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Give Prozvatov the Sharks. And look at that stretch. What is that? 10 days where Georgiev's not really getting to. So if he's
and so, I'll be honest. This is the double-edged sword with Alexander Georgiev. He is very openly talked about. I don't like sitting for long stretches.
Right.
I don't like going a long time without playing. And I feel like he struggles when he comes off of breaks like that. So he's one of those goalies that it's weird because your knee jerk is like, hey, we'll give him some time off to mentally reset. He doesn't like that.
Well, maybe that's just something he needs to kind of overcome on his own, right? Because look at Ivan Prozvatov. It took so long for him to get his first start, and he was like, no, I was doing great. I was practicing every day. We were really, you know, working hard at practice, making sure everything was staying fine-tuned. And
the mindset of a backup is different than the mindset of a number one, though.
Yeah, sure. But I think, again, that's just something you got to just stop it, you know? Like,
just stop.
Just slap him in the hand and say, just stop being like
that. Stop doing that.
But no, I think there's definitely another level to Alexander Georgiev. So I think, again, along with Makar's drought, Miko's drought, everything, the bodies falling out of the lineup, Alexander Georgiev just going through a little bit of a slide. I'm more than confident that he's going to eventually get back to the Alexander Georgiev that we saw at the beginning of the season. It's just about the experimentation using the regular season to figure out how to best get him there.
Yes, I agree with you.
Okay. Goalie conversation over.
Only if you're done. You're the
Ivan
boss
Prozvatov.
Here, JJ.
I talked to Ivan Prozvatov about his toe ties because his toe tie setup is so different than any other goalie you see. You see his pads sitting a lot higher.
Tell the folks at home what a toe tie is.
Okay, I gotta simplify it that much, right? So on your pad, at the bottom of the pad, you have a string that you tie to your skate that really helps the pad stay in place, right? I remember Calvin Pickard turned me on to an elastic version of that, which was really great, really helped my ankles from getting overextended. But I'm assuming Ivan Prosbatov didn't like those. So what he has is a little bit longer of a string from the skate to the pad. Some people are probably loving this. Some people are so bored.
Well, I don't think people are bored. I think there's people that are just like, what the fuck's a toe tie?
What are you talking about? Yeah. So his pad sits higher. So if you just see a picture of him head on, you can see way more of his skate than you can see on any other goalie, right? Which is so unique. And he had 9 different reasons why he did it. But he essentially just likes his pad to sit higher and keeps it loose on his foot, but keeps it really tight kind of around the calf and everything like that. So kind of allows his mobility to be more free.
Mobile.
Yeah. Mobility to be more there. All right.
I think that's super interesting.
I liked it too. Yeah. I mean, I went up to him off the record just because I was genuinely curious. Like, what the hell you got going on down there?
Yeah.
And I love how open he was and just immediately started, oh, I do this.
He's a chatty guy.
Yeah. I just said, hey, I'm curious about your toe tie setup. It's definitely unique. And he's like, yeah, and just went on for like 3 minutes breaking it all down for me. So I feel like an expert on
He
that.
Chats with Mark all the time now. We were leaving the locker room to go down to coach and fucking Prozzy.
You can tell the people who Mark is?
I mean, we talk about Mark all the time. Mark's always the guy that's on the other side of the lens. He's usually on the back side of the lens making sure that you can see us.
True pro.
He's
what makes us look good.
Yeah. He's
him and Coach Prime.
Yeah, him and Coach Prime. But yeah, Prozzy yelled something out to him in Russian. I don't know. And so I'm standing there like waiting to go down to coach, and Mark's not, like, everyone's out of the locker room. Mark's still in there. I was like, yo, and he comes out big smile and says, like, oh, he was just yucking it up. And I was like, what did he say? He's like, nothing. He was just joking around. It's like,
I know the feeling. This podcast's kind of scattered, but I was when I was in the Buffalo Sabres locker room last night, Tyson Jost came up to me and was like, hey, nice. Man, what's up? And I was like, it's cool to like feel remembered.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Not just some guy that annoys me with his microphones.
Yeah.
Nathan MacKinnon on a 13-point streak. I think we just got to touch on it. Yeah. Nothing really I want to say that's going to, you know, blow anyone's mind, but
I want to give a shout out to our boy Arif because he asked Nolan Pratt, what's wrong with Nathan MacKinnon? And then I don't think Nathan MacKinnon has not picked up a point since Arif asked that. So shout out to our boy Arif Dean.
And shout out to Nathan MacKinnon for just ripping it.
Well, I mean, dude, what's crazy about Nathan MacKinnon right now is that it seems like every point, every goal is nasty. Like, he's not – earlier this season – I understood why people were like, what's wrong with Nathan MacKinnon? He was picking up ugly points. He was well over a point per game player. He'd been trending to have his most productive year ever all season. But a lot of the points were just kind of ugly secondary assists, you know, a little bump pass here. So, you know, people didn't like it. But on this 13-game point streak, it seems like every assist is nice. Every goal is nice. And then he's got 2 games in a row where he's absolutely laid guys out. He's playing physical. He's playing with speed. His play in the offensive zone right now is ridiculous. And what I loved about that playoff sign is he's the last man back on a 2-on-1. He's comfortable jumping into the middle of the ice. You know, he's checking both guys. He had some help coming back. So he's like, yeah, I can step into Jeff Skinner.
Well, look at the Philadelphia game, right? The Avalanche were fighting their way back into that, and then there was a breakaway for Philadelphia, and Nathan MacKinnon was back-checking his ass off. He was just flying down the ice, caught up to the guy, and ended up getting a penalty shot. The game kind of collapsed from there. But just that effort he put into the back check was just like, this is a different version of Nathan MacKinnon. This is more of a captain Nathan MacKinnon.
Mm-hmm.
I love seeing him go to the refs, calmly talk to them in situations. Yes, sir, there's moments where he's yelling at them. There's moments where he's losing a little bit, but most of the time, he's calmly walking up, doing his captain thing. Hey, can we get an explanation? Hey, we thought you missed this, and that. And not to mention, he's a little bit more pleasant in the locker room than he's ever been before. So Nathan MacKinnon right now, Mikko Rantanen was in a drought. Valanichushkin was in a drought. Those are Nathan MacKinnon's line mates.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Jonathan Drouin's had a hard time getting going. And nonetheless, Nathan MacKinnon still on a 13-point streak.
Yep. 13-game point streak. You've left the word game out both times you said that, and I let it go by the first time.
Does it bother you that much?
Well, you said 13-point streak. Yeah. Like 13 months?
Point streak.
13-point streak. 13 consecutive points?
We didn't really touch on Eric Johnson at all today. I know it was all we touched on yesterday, so I don't know if there's much else to do.
We didn't even talk about the Mikko Rantanen stuff, which, I mean, again, I guess that's another one that it's been pretty thoroughly talked about the last couple days.
Yeah, we got into his drought. I mean,
what did you think of the whole? Mikko told us 2 days ago, the day after the, you know, the kind of blow up after the game, that he said, "Look, journalists have a job. Their job is, you know, to analyze and critique what we do on the ice. I have no problem with that. Say what you want to say about it." When you start digging into off-ice stuff, and he said, and lying about where I'm at, what I'm doing, that's where it's a problem. And I think it's totally fair for him to feel that way. You know, you want to say he's not playing well? Cool. Don't say he's not playing well because he fucked around all summer and this, that, and the other, if that's not the case.
Yeah, it obviously rattled them who it came from, right? If me and you sat here and were like, what was Mikko Rantanen doing in the offseason? I doubt he'd even catch wind of it. But coming from Arturi Lehkonen's father probably was a little bit of a jab to him, and he just wanted to respond. And whatever, it's fine. I'm for the little WWE showmanship, and I know it was completely genuine from Mikko Rantanen, but I love whatever. Give us something to spice up the night. It was a Monday night.
My thing with it always is I laugh when I see people on Twitter because they'll take shots at, you know, people in our position, you know, media. And then if the media, you know, personality like kind of claps back at them, like, wow, tag their employer. Are you okay with your employees talking to people like this? It's like, don't come in here and say something if you aren't expecting someone to say something back to you. And I thought that was kind of the same thing with the Mikko situation. EJ, I'm going to tell this one story, and then this is kind of all I've got. It's very, very, very brief. Yesterday, I was the first one into the room. EJ has always been nothing but fantastic with me. Had a great chat with him when we were in Buffalo. You know, he asked about my wife and all that stuff. Eric Johns is an outstanding dude. So, you know, walking yesterday, and we're just kind of, while I was waiting for everyone else to funnel in, because obviously I didn't want to just like, you know, just catching up, you know, how you been, how are things going? And I said, is it nice to be home? And then I stopped. I said, well, is it nice to be back? And he got this real big smile on his face and he goes, it's great to be home. And I knew that was going to happen, dude. I knew that was going to happen. Again. Yeah. He said, it's great to be home. And I just thought that was a really nice little touch, you know, from him that this is his home. This is where he wants to be. And, you know, go watch the interview. Maybe I'll even, you know, just plop it on the end of this just so people can see it. I said yesterday on Twitter, it was one of the better media scrums I've been a part of in my career here. So, yeah, it was great. It was great to see him.
Throw in Cardi B, too, if you can. How much longer do you think he has in the league? Because I feel like the way he's talking, it's almost like, of course, pure speculation from my part. He's got a job lined up here, it feels like, with the Avalanche, here in Colorado. And that's why he's very much like, I love this organization. I love everything. And yes, he does. He genuinely feels that way. But I also think there was a little extra showmanship to it of like, you know, pumping up the organization.
You mean like to come back as a player or, front office? Yeah. I would be willing to bet that he'll test the free agent market one more time this summer, depending on how his body's feeling. I thought he would go somewhere like Anaheim because he already has a house there. You know, so if there's a team next year willing to give him a 1-by-1 or 1-by-2 or something like that. Yeah, you know, I think he could play another year. But I'm with you. I think that dude's got a job lined up immediately the second he wants it.
Indeed, indeed. I wanted to end the podcast with this quick little hypothetical conversation for fun. And again, it's purely for fun, and it's purely hypothetical. So make sure you listen to my entire question before you react.
Push the mic away.
Craig Berube was fired this week. whatever. What would it take for Jared Bednar to suddenly be on the hot seat or out of town? Again, I know this is extreme, and we're nowhere near this, but I think it was an interesting question that was posed to me, and I just kind of floated around.
I mean,
felt
timely about
with Craig
on
Rubin.
Ice?
On ice. It doesn't, yeah, obviously something egregious, like, yeah, he drunk drives into a school bus of children.
I mean,
sure. It's just so far from it right
well,
now.
I was
and
gonna say,
what,
I mean, like, I mean, you're literally talking about like a full this fully healthy Avalanche team. You know, wins 15 games the rest of the way. Like honestly, that's like what you're talking. Or you know, they'd have to lose seriously like 15 in a row, and there'd have to be like obvious
mismanagement,
disdain from the players about, you know, the way he's doing things. You know, he scratches Nathan MacKinnon or something like. I mean, it would have to be. I mean, it would have to be in the same way. It's an extreme hypothetical. It'd have to be extreme circumstances,
like 3 10-0 losses in
right
a row.
In yeah. a row at the end of a 10-game losing streak, where yeah, he's pissed off Nathan MacKinnon and Cale Makar and. You know, I mean, said publicly, we're going to Ivan Prosvetov, and you know, like it would have to be this like crazy hard right turn. Because I mean, I think Jared Bednar is one of the safest jobs in pro sports right now.
And that's what I wanted. That's why I wanted to do this exercise, because it's crazy how he is at the top of the league. I think he's either 2 or 3 as far as tenured coaches.
John Cooper's on
there. There you go. He's the second longest tenured coach, and he's still so far away from even being close to where Craig Berube is now, which is the golf course, likely. But man, could they use them? Could use him in Buffalo?
Craig Berube?
Yeah.
Nah.
I was really shocked by the vibe I picked up in that locker room yesterday.
I think he's too old school. I think he would not connect well with the young players they've got there in Buffalo. I think that's part of the reason why he's probably out in St. Louis. They know they got to turn the page.
Right on, right on. Well, we've got 3 games ahead: Winnipeg, San Jose, Chicago. You know we'll be at all of them. Especially you. You'll be in Winnipeg and Chicago. I'll be here for San Jose. So thanks for hanging out with us today on this edition of Guerilla Hockey with JJ and Jesse. Closing thoughts?
You're the best. Love your shades.
These are cool shades, aren't they? Probably the cheapest pair of sunglasses I bought in 10 years, too.
Ooh,
quality stuff. Nice. Thanks for hanging out with us, everybody. We'll see you later.